Hi, everybody. Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Well, you never know how the simple steps you take now will change your life down the road. And no one knows that better than Connor Grennan.
In Nepal, there are over 400 families that consider Connor a hero. It all started because of a choice he made to volunteer at an orphanage for 3 months. Watch this.
At 29 years old, Connor Grennan decided to leave a successful career and take a year-long trip around the world. To kick off this global adventure, Connor volunteered at an orphanage in Nepal for 3 months, mostly because he wanted to impress his friends and family. But over time, he had a change of heart. Connor came to love the children, and they formed a strong bond. When time came for him to leave, he promised to return. The following year, Connor kept his word and came back. One day, he learned some startling news. These children weren't orphans at all. They had been trafficked.
Well, please welcome Connor, the author of Little Princesses, to 700 Club Interactive. That's kind of a crazy thing to say, I'm going to volunteer at an orphanage for 3 months. What got you to do that?
You know, it's sort of, it's always a little embarrassing to say, but the fact was I was just going to travel around the world, and I decided, you know, my friends were kind of giving me a little bit of grief, and they said, you know, you should really volunteer somewhere, so I decided, okay, I guess I'll volunteer. I went in very reluctantly, and then eventually just got there, and the kids just sort of overtook me, and I really fell in love with the kids out there.
Why Nepal?
You know, it was just the first stop on the trip, and I just thought, I'm going to have this good, you know, trip of fun. I wasn't a Christian at the time. I was just kind of thinking, oh, this is going to be a great, you know, year-long trip. And let me get this out of the way first, because I'm not going to care about this. And it ended up changing my life.
All right, you said you weren't a Christian at the time. So you're just coming in it literally to, okay, I need an excuse to say I'm going to take a year off and travel the world.
Yeah.
And, you know, it needs to look good for my friends.
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
All right, you go to Nepal. I mean, that's kind of, it's the only Hindu nation. I mean, Hinduism is the official language. A lot of Buddhists there.
Yeah.
And you became a Christian.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Well, right, who would have thought, right? I mean, I was, and you know, even the years before that, I was living in Eastern Europe, which is not the most Christian part of the world either. So I'm over there, and I get an email from this woman named Liz Flanagan. Mm-hmm. And what Liz does is she's saying, look, I'm coming over to India. Why don't I come over and volunteer for a couple days? And we became friends. And when I met Liz, she was a Christian. And I had this idea about Christianity that it was sort of closed-minded and, you know, just for ourselves and everything. And she came and she just opened my world. I mean, all the kids were all over her, and she just had this incredible heart. And I decided, I'm going to learn a little more about this, you know, because maybe what I know isn't what I think I know. And I bought probably the only Bible in Kathmandu. I found one in an old bookstore and opened the gospel. And I swear, I was a few pages in, and I was just like, wow, this is nothing what I expected, and just changed my heart completely.
Wow. That's an amazing, I mean, not just of all the conversion stories I've heard, that's, you know, I bought a Bible in an old bookstore in Kathmandu, and it changed my life.
You don't hear it every day.
No, you don't. let's get to the orphanage. And you found out that these aren't really orphans, mm-hmm. that their parents were alive. How did they get there?
Yeah, it was really amazing. I mean, we literally were just, you know, in the orphanage one day. I'd been there for months now. I was really, you know, had a heart for these kids now. And a woman came to the orphanage. And
so the 3 months turned into...
The 3 months, you know, I went around the world and I said, I'm going to come back there. You know, this is the right place for me. Came back for another 3 months. There was a civil war going on. It wasn't the safest place to be, but I knew the kids needed a little bit more help.
It was a very violent time.
Very violent time, exactly. And this woman came and said, you know, look, I think you have two of my kids in your home. And we thought, that's impossible. These are orphans. But sure enough, as it turned out, you know, all these kids came from the mountains, which we knew, and the Maoist rebels had been abducting kids, very young kids, 5, 6, 7 year olds, like the kids that you see in the photos there, you know, to sort of do their work for them. And parents were desperate to get them out of these situations, out of the mountains and into a safe place. And so traffickers came through and said, look, I'll take care of your kid. Let me take them to Kathmandu Valley. They'll get an education. They'll be safe from the Maoists, and they'll come back in 10 years. Now you have to pay me. You got to pay basically your life savings because it's going to be expensive. Parents sacrificed everything to save their 5, 6, 7 year old kids. And these kids essentially went to Kathmandu, and they became slaves for this guy. He cut off their parents, who were so remote that he could never get back in touch with them. You know, sold them into slavery, sold them into international adoption. He sent them out on the streets to beg for him, saying, oh, I'm an orphan, please give me money. That money went right into his pocket.
Wow. Wow. And you're not working at his orphanage.
Correct. These kids were rescued before
they
got there.
They were rescued out of that.
Exactly.
And put into a safe environment. And what efforts were made to find their parents?
Well, this is what we realized. You know, I was like, I went back to New York still thinking, you know what, that was a nice experience, but I'm kind of done with Nepal now. And then I got an email very quickly. The revolution was happening in Nepal, very violent time, as you said. And we found that seven of our kids got stolen by the trafficker. And I thought, oh, my gosh. I just got to get back there. I don't know what to do. But I decided I'm just going to go back and try to find them. Again, I only became a Christian through this after watching the miracles of actually finding children when I had no right to find children in the city of millions of people. But I found them one by one. I was like, this is a miracle. But I realized these kids have to have a future. We have to find their families. Well, I mean, just, you know, I was literally on the back of a motorcycle going through the monsoon, going from, you know, orphanage to orphanage. And then one day I was in this village. I knew that, you know, a girl was being held by the wife of a trafficker, but I had no idea where she was. And I'm just thinking, oh, man. And I met Liz online by this time, and she's like, just pray for it. You know, why don't you just, like, hope for a miracle? And I was like, well, I'm never going to find her, but, you know, please, God, let me find her. And I can't tell you what this moment was like. She was all of a sudden there. Just in the street, and I just grabbed her and took her to my house. You know, got her out of the, and she had just walked out of the trafficker's house at that moment. I saw her, grabbed her, and took her. And then I realized, you know what? These kids need families. They need their families. And everybody said, how are you going to find them? I was like, I don't know. I have no idea how to do it. But I knew that if I just got into the mountains, places where there's no roads, they've never even seen a wheeled vehicle in their lives, let alone been inside a car. They've never seen electricity. They've never seen a light bulb. But I'm like, I'm just going to walk through these mountains for a few weeks with photos of the kids and just try to find their families. And one by one, I didn't come back until I found every single one. It took about 4 weeks of walking through the mountains.
And you found every single family for seven kids who had been stolen.
24. I found, 24. Yeah, I actually brought more, you know, more kids from our children's home. And I just brought all those photos of the kids with me. And, you know, I got snowed in. I got injured. A lot of bad things happened. But that actually also just, you know, it kind of grew my faith as well. I'm like, wow, there, I have no reason that I should be able to find these families deep in these mountains. There's no reason, but somehow I was just led to those places.
You've started an organization to help kids, and tell us about that.
Yeah, Next Generation Nepal. It's, you know, I realized before I went back out to Nepal, I was dead broke. You know, dead broke. I didn't even have enough money to afford a plane ticket to get back and start looking for the kids. And so I just asked my family, asked my friends, asked anybody I knew, Could you donate? So that's what I realized. Starting an organization would help me raise money like that. And so with Next Generation Nepal, what we do now is we just go into the mountains. We try to find these families. I mean, what started with 24 kids, now we've found about 400 families. There's no shortcut. We literally just have to put on backpacks and walk and not come back until we find those families. Because I'll tell you, if it's your child, if it's my child, I also wouldn't want anybody coming back until they had found that child or that family. So that's what we do now. We're in a place of the world that not a lot of people know about. Oh, these kids, there's 15,000 of them still missing, and we're just not giving up.
Do you take volunteers to come work with you? Or?
Yeah, we have a partnership with another organization that we work at out there. So people can, you know, get in touch with us through Next Generation Nepal. And, you know, if they want to volunteer, we have places for them to volunteer with the kids out there. You know, if they want to just work in their community and help us raise awareness, raise funds, I mean, we're just so appreciative of that, too. But people want to get involved, and look, we live on a shoestring. We don't take big money from people. It's just little donations that get us by.
I imagine it's difficult that anyone who has gotten to the point where they're willing to traffic a child, they're not going to give up easily. I would assume this is very dangerous work.
Yeah, it is, and we've just been seeing that more recently, too. We just rescued 20 kids. Who are, you know, under sort of the control of a trafficker. We've been able to tell people we've rescued them, but haven't been able to share more details, obviously, because the children are in danger. You know, these guys make a lot of money on this. And anytime somebody's making a lot of money off the backs of kids, whether it's, you know, through drugs, prostitution, or slavery, as we see, they're not giving up easily. So we've run into a lot of problems with that.
Well, what would you tell somebody? I think a lot of people in America today, and particularly young people, are wondering, can I make a difference? Can I possibly do anything? I mean, there's so many forces in the world today that you just look at it and you just go, how can you do anything? What would you tell them?
Yeah, I'm so glad you asked that, because it's really the reason I wrote the book in the first place. I always felt like volunteering was for the kind of person that volunteered. You know, if you're that kind of person, you have a heart for it, That's who should do it. Well, I'll tell you, my initial reason for going out there was to impress people. I kind of wanted to use it as a pickup line. You know, I mean, like, there was a whole lot of reasons why I went out there. None of them had anything to do with helping kids. But I'll tell you what, it was the volunteering itself that changed my heart. You know, it's the volunteering itself that, you know, and led me down, you know, to a path of faith and everything else. But just even short of that, I'll tell you what, it's the passion you get from volunteering. It's the skill you get from, and compassion comes from volunteering. So what I would say to people, just take that first step. You never know where it's going to lead. And I'll tell you what, if you don't give up, you'll make a difference. Believe me, you know, I shouldn't have been doing this work. I had no business doing it. But the fact that I just didn't give up, I think that that's what made the difference.
And then you find you actually get good at it.
And then you get good at it. And then you bring other people on board. And then, you know, you start spreading the word. And then, you know, when you're blessed as much as I've been, you get the chance to write a book and actually spread the word about these kids.
Yeah. All right, for you watching, if you want to get involved, we've got a link on CBN.com. Little Princess is available in bookstores nationwide if you want to read more about Connor and his amazing adventure. And then realize this, let his story be an inspiration for you. Life can be a great adventure. You don't have to sort of walk through, okay, I'm going to go to high school, and I'm going to college, and I'm going to graduate school, I'm going to have a career. You can have an adventure. All it takes is taking the risk to say, okay, I'm willing. I'll volunteer. I'll go somewhere. I'll do something unusual. And you can be like Connor. Great story.
Yeah,
love it.
Thank you so much. Thanks.
Well, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Terry, over to you.
Well, when we come back, abandoned at birth, illiterate, and no one to believe in him. Find out how you change this child's life. Stay with us.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home, laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you. And I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking. Came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing. But we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
On a trip to Zambia, I met a boy named Christopher who was forced to work as a servant in his uncle's home. Although illiterate and without a support system, Christopher had an unstoppable dream. Take a look.
We change a nation by reaching the young people and changing the next generation. To have their hearts and their minds changed. Then to be able to educate them and know that they could become the leaders of their countries. I mean, this is how you change a nation, by reaching the young people.
I want you to be a great student, and you're going to be a wonderful leader for your people. Mm-hmm. God's got big plans for you.
There are some of the kids that just stand out, like Christopher. I think he was one of your favorite kids that you met on this trip.
Well, some of these kids, and Christopher is right at the top of the list, have had things done to them that the average person would be
bitter, angry, frustrated, maybe even violent because of the way they've been treated by other people. But what I saw in Christopher that so drew me to him was this, just this sweet spirit.
Can you recap his story a little bit?
Yeah, he's just a jewel. I mean, 14 now, and mother abandoned him at birth. So right there, most kids would have deep rejection issues. A father who gets ill and dies, so now he's abandoned again. And then he's sent to live with someone who he calls uncle, but I don't even really think this man is related to him. So really what Christopher has done is he's gone into this home as their chore boy and their donkey herder. He doesn't have a hope here. And they took him to the government school, and the government school said he can't come here. He doesn't read, he doesn't write, he's 12 years old, we can't take him. They must have heard about the school that we support, the mixed school, and brought him there. Even they didn't know what to do with him because he was so old. They said he'd have to start with the kindergartners, assuming that he wouldn't want to do that, that he would be too proud to do that. And the next morning, after they'd said they couldn't take him, they opened the door and there's Christopher. To just say, I will not be refused a future. I mean, that's, as a mom, you know, I look at that kid and I think, he's never really had love. He's never really had anybody who's told him what a great kid he is. And he's got so much potential. In 3 years, he's moved from kindergarten up to the fourth grade. He knows he's behind, but he knows he can do it. I think that's an amazing thing. Who gives that to a child normally? Their parents, you know. He's not had that from anyone. And so to be able to say to him, you know, Orphans Promise is going to sponsor you in to live here.
What did you tell me yesterday was the thing you wanted more than anything?
To be in boarding.
To be in boarding. Well, you know what? Orphans Promise is going to sponsor you. So as of today, this is your new home.
Thank you.
You are so welcome. You know, I want you to know that God heard your prayer. And last night I woke up and I was thinking about you. And you know what I thought? I thought about how, do you know who David was in the Bible? Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was a great man of God. And you know what he was first? A shepherd boy. Mm-hmm. And that's what you've been, a shepherd boy, and you've been faithful to that. And God wants to do something powerful for you. That was his dream, that he could leave where he was, stop riding to school in the cold and the dark in the morning all by himself, stop leaving at the end of the day to go herd donkeys, to never have light at home because he's got all these chores to do. He gets to the evening, there's no light to do his homework by. I asked him, what's the difference between the house with your uncle where you live and coming to school here? And he really got tears in his eyes and he said, well, at my uncle's house, the children say to me, this is not your home. You don't really belong here. But at this school, I feel like it's my family and I have a mom and a dad.
Mm-hmm. Before you came here, did you know anything about God's love for you?
No.
No. So tell me what you've learned about that here at mixed school.
At mixed, I've learned that God is helpful and he can give you what you don't have.
To be able to tell him that he has a hope and a future, that his dreams are not just dreams, that they can be reality, and that we all see that in him. You know, we get to be the parents he never had and come alongside of him and say, keep going, you're doing a great job. I fully believe that one day Christopher may be the president of Zambia. And it would be God's gift to Zambia should he rise to that height.
He's something special, isn't he? And you know, there are kids like that around the world, kids with dreams, kids with goals, with things they'd like to be and do. I honestly don't know how they survive in the midst of their need. There's nothing to cause them to believe that it can come to pass except that innate hope that God plants in the heart of a child. that needs to be watered and tended and loved into fulfillment. And you and I have the privilege of doing that with kids around the world. Orphans Promise is investing in the lives of children just like Christopher in 54 countries now. We're only able to do that because you stand with us. If you'd like to be a part of seeing this happen in the lives of kids who don't have anyone to belong to, nobody to love them, no one to surround them with understanding and courage and drive, be a part of Orphans Promise. Give to us today. You can give by calling the number on your screen, 888-777-1999. You can also log on to cbn.com and give that way. But we can make a difference, you and I. Sometimes making a difference in the life of one child turns out to change a nation. Be a part of that. It's exciting. Well, up next, we've got your inbox questions. Deborah and her husband have a blended family, and the kids are struggling with hurts from both sides. They're not sure how to move on as a family. We're going to talk about that right after this.
This is the information retailers don't want you to know, especially now. They don't want you to learn just how much money you've been giving away to retail markups on items you purchase for your home, all because you don't know how to buy like the insiders do at Direct Buy Club, the home improvement and furnishings club with direct insider prices.
When you go to Direct Buy, you know that things are going to be a lot less than retail, and you don't have to worry about sales. It's just, you know, one price, and it's a low price too.
I would shop around and investigate, and without a shadow of a doubt, Direct Buy would have the lowest price.
Members buy top quality name brand merchandise from hundreds and hundreds of trusted manufacturers. So call the number on your screen now and we'll rush you your free visitor's pass to your local Direct Buy Club and your certificate for a free 30-day membership. This is a limited offer, so call now.
Well, we've got some questions from some of you that have been submitted via the inbox, and so we want to address some of those. This is Dylan who writes, I am a college student in Minneapolis, and I found out that someone I knew before I got saved was shot and killed by her boyfriend. She was 16 years old with a baby, and he was 17 years old. It's been really hard for me. Can you please pray?
Dylan, this is one of those where you look and you just are overwhelmed with the tragedy of it, not just for the girl who was shot and killed, but for the one who did it. Here's a 17-year-old boy, and he's going to face a life in jail because of this. And then on top of all of that, you have a young baby. And how does this baby grow up? And how do we, you know, deal with these things? Yes, you can get judgmental and condemn the boy. You can condemn the whole situation. Why are they having children? You can look at it from that standpoint. But I would encourage you to look at it from the standpoint of love and how love never fails and why God didn't intend any of these bad things to happen. This wasn't his plan. It wasn't his purpose for her life, for their lives. But how can it be redeemed now? And when you start looking from that standpoint, and if you're moved with compassion and you want to do something, you know, how can you reach out to the young man that did this horrible crime? You've got to understand he's hurting now, and he's feeling all kinds of grief on his own, as well as regret, as well as anger. And I imagine he feels incredible rejection from everyone around him. And how can you reach out to the baby? So start looking at it from that standpoint. What can I do? And when you do, you'll find the redemption you're looking for. You'll find how can you make a difference here? And with that comes a whole lot of purpose. We'll be praying. Mm-hmm. I know the chat room will be praying for you right now. But look at it from those eyes and from the eyes of how did Jesus deal with the tragedies around him? What would he try to do in order to redeem the situation? And you can do the same thing. Next question comes in from Deborah, who writes, our whole family is experiencing grief. We're a blended family. My husband's teenage girls are expressing their anger at me. because of their birth mother who left them. I understand why they're angry, but it's not an easy thing to go through. Then add the grief that my husband and I have experienced due to our divorces, and we really need prayer. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that one, Terry?
Wow. Well, you know, we all need prayer. You need prayer, you're right. But I would suggest also that it would be really, really helpful if you could get some counseling. I would suggest for you and your husband that you get counseling together from this standpoint. You know, sometimes when things happen to us in our lives and we're wounded in our hearts and then we come into another relationship, it's sometimes a little awkward to talk about those things with each other. We don't even know how to get to the heart of the matter. And that's where a counselor comes in. And, you know, so many people feel like if I go to a counselor, it means I'm weak, it means I'm crazy. None of the above. It means that you're open to being helped. I would make sure it's a Christian counselor who can bring the word of God into that because there's some healing needed. And as far as your teenage girls are concerned or your husband's teenage girls, boy, I think it's great that you do have some understanding why they're projecting that anger onto you. They need some help, too, processing all of that. And as long as you and your husband are trying to work out your relationship with each other, which is what you need to do because children need parents to be strong and committed to each other, they need somebody to help them work through those comments and the feelings that they've got in a place that's acceptable for them to express that. Somebody help them work through their anger. And all of that's very normal. You also need some friends to undergird your family in prayer. Boy, I think that's so important. And to remember that everybody's family has issues. It's not just your family. But get some help. Get some help for your family. I would encourage that.
Amen. It's time to take some prayer calls. Here's Eliezer from Connecticut. How can we pray for you?
Hi, yes. Yeah.
Hi.
I hurt my back in 2008, and I've just been praying for healing ever since then.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I forgave those who, you know, offended me. I don't have anger in my heart. I just sometimes I just don't understand why I just don't get healed.
Okay. How did you injure your back?
I used to work at a gym, and I was lifting the plates, and it's just, I guess with working out and plus my job, I stressed my back out. I went to doctors, and all they say is just drink ibuprofen, but it's just not enough. You know, it doesn't do anything.
Okay. Well, God can do a lot of things. Do you have faith in Him?
I have a lot of faith in God.
Okay. Let me just challenge you. Don't have faith in any kind of prayer. Don't have faith in your faith. Don't have faith in any ritual. Just have faith in Him. And remember this verse. It's one of the great ones. Even when we're unfaithful, He remains faithful. He cannot deny Himself. And part of who He is, one of His names, He is the Lord our healer. He is the healer of all who come to Him. And so all you have to do is present yourself to Him. So right now, can you reach that area that's in pain?
Can you reach?
All right, okay, just put a hand on it right now.
All right.
And Lord, we just join with Eliezer right now, and we speak healing into his back. And we come to you in faith, believing that you are God. You are our healer. And in Jesus' name, we speak healing into this back. We speak warmth. We speak anointing. We say to every muscle, relax now. We say to every vertebra, be normal now. We speak to every disc now, be normal. And the anointing of healing, just flow through that back now. Release all the strain, all the damage, all the inflammation, be gone now. In Jesus' name, amen. Eliezer, can you stand up for me?
Oh, yes.
And can you, like, twist your back? How does that feel?
Feels better.
Yeah. Can you bend over for me?
Oh, yeah.
How does that feel?
Feel better. Thank you.
Thank you for calling.
Everybody, thank you.
All right. God bless you. Mm-hmm. That's all the time we have for this program. We leave you this wonderful word from Matthew, that Jesus said, "Let the children come to me. Don't stop them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." God bless you.